If you were alive and living in London in the year 1535, and you went to church on Sunday, June 13th, whatever church you went to, you would have heard the same sermon preached from every pulpit. It was a sermon of condemnation against the traitors, Bishop John Fisher of Rochester in England, and Sir Thomas More. These were two of the most widely respected men in the kingdom. And yet, to the everlasting shame of the Catholic clergy, they all preached that sermon against them. How did this come about? Well, of course, you know the very famous story. King Henry VIII, King of England, wanted a male heir, and so he asked the Pope to annul his marriage to Queen Catherine of Aragon so that he could marry his mistress, Anne Boleyn. Henry, not being given the annulment by the Pope, declared himself to be the supreme head of the Catholic Church in England. He then granted himself the annulment and eventually proceeded to marry Anne Boleyn, his mistress, and make her queen. As we know very famously, King Henry would go on to have 6 wives in total, 2 of whom he would divorce, and 2 of whom he would execute, including Anne. But the king at this time also had passed something called the Act of Supremacy. And this required that every important person in the kingdom had to take an oath. And it was an oath where they swore that they recognized Henry as the supreme head of the church and not the Pope. And this was the crime of treason, and it was punishable by death. And so it's in this context that Bishop John Fisher and Sir Thomas More found themselves in the year 1535. Bishop Fisher was the one who was tried first. He was tried just days after that sermon was preached against him and More in the great hall of Westminster in the city of London. It still stands today. It's about 1,000 years old. It was old even when Fisher and More were on trial there. And Fisher was broken in health by his imprisonment in the Tower of London. He had been the Chancellor of Cambridge University. Henry himself had nominated Fisher to be a bishop and had said that there is no prince or kingdom in all of Christendom that can boast a more distinguished prelate. And yet Fisher found himself on trial for his life. He defended himself magnificently, with great humility, but great eloquence. So much so that the judges openly wept when they sentenced him for the crime of treason to death. Fisher was executed on this date, June 22nd, on Tower Hill, just outside the Tower of London. He was beheaded. And his friend in life would follow him as a martyr in death, Sir Thomas More. More, whose picture you see next to me at the pulpit, was only 57 years old. He was a husband and a father. He was a lawyer. He was Sheriff of London. He also served as a member of Parliament and then a judge, rising and rising until eventually he was named by Henry to be the Lord Chancellor of all England, really the king's most trusted advisor, the second most powerful man in the land. But of course, More was also a profoundly religious man who believed his faith and who lived his faith. And so he and the king were on a collision course. the king's will against the layman's faith. And Henry understood that if he could win over Moore, it would give his action great credibility because of Moore's profound reputation as being the most honest man in all of England. Moore understood that he could not do what the king wanted. And so, eventually, in conscience, he resigned his commission. And he even famously took the symbol of his authority, the Great Seal of England, and returned it to the king in person, putting it in the king's own hand. This reduced him and his family almost immediately to poverty. He had gone from the height of society to the dregs of society. No one would have anything to do with him. But for 2 years, everyone from the king down tried to get him to take the oath, to tell a lie. And perhaps the greatest cross for Thomas Moore was that even members of his own family tried to persuade him to lie to save his life. They did it, of course, out of love, because they didn't want to see him suffer. But Moore understood that faith was more important than suffering, because that is what our Lord taught us. And so, just 2 weeks after Fisher, Moore stood in the same spot in Westminster Hall. There was a panel of judges before him, but they had forgotten that they had in the man Moore one of the most brilliant minds in history, and certainly one of the most brilliant legal minds that they had ever contended with. And we have a transcript of his trial. We know what the judges said, what the witnesses said, and what Moore responded. It's absolutely magnificent, even 500 years later, to read those words. He himself was sick because of 14 months spent in the Tower of London, but he defended himself brilliantly. But of course, it didn't matter. Richard Rich, who was at that time the Solicitor General of England and Wales, perjured himself in order to have Moore convicted. Richard Rich, interestingly, was the only witness against Bishop Fisher 2 weeks before. And serving on the panel of judges to condemn Sir Thomas was his successor as Lord Chancellor of England and the father, uncle, and brother of Queen Anne Boleyn. Moore was condemned, and on July 6, in the year 1535, he was taken to the same spot on Tower Hill where Fisher had preceded him. And Moore stood before the people and, always known as a great wit, said, "I pray that you will pray for me, and I promise that I will pray for you, but elsewhere." And then he said explicitly, "I die in and for the Holy Catholic faith." And then, of course, as he got ready to kneel down to give his life as a martyr, as a witness for Christ, he said to the people, "I die the king's good servant, but God's first." My brothers and sisters, in one of the greatest ironies of history, 475 years later, the Pope himself stood in that Westminster Hall on the very site of the trial and condemnation of St. John Fisher and St. Thomas Moore. And Pope Benedict XVI addressed the combined Houses of Parliament. And on that date, in 2010, he said these words, "The dilemma which faced Moore in those difficult times is the perennial question of the relationship between what is owed to Caesar and what is owed to God. One of the greatest scholars of St. Thomas More in modern times is Father Germain Marcador, a French priest who is still alive at the age of 99. And some years ago, he wrote these words, which are so important for us to listen to today. It may be that in the near future, we will face, all of us, the problem of harmonizing, or simply reconciling, our loyalty to Caesar with our loyalty to God. Caesar, moreover, is no longer a monarch. He is a cabinet or a party. He is a public opinion, which shapes and is shaped by the newspapers, the broadcasts, the schools. There are today fields of conduct, such as divorce, sexual behavior and education, the use of artificial contraceptives, abortion, mercy killing, and a few more, in which a Catholic, especially if he is a lawyer, a doctor, a nurse, or a teacher, will find himself alone against practically every one of those in his profession. He will even find fellow Catholics ready to taunt him. In extreme cases, fidelity to the doctrine of Mother Church will mean worse than corporal death. It will alienate from a man the trust and esteem of the people he likes or even loves. The prospect of this social disqualification, of this civic annihilation, is as strong and effective a pressure as the old forms of physical duress. Thousands will apostatize simply because they see no rational justification in the church's position, and they have not enough faith. In those times, let us turn to Thomas More. My brothers and sisters, you may well think that this was written to address the circumstances that we are living in this very year. Father Marcador wrote these words in 1961, nearly 60 years ago. But they are so timely, as are the lives and witness of St. John Fisher and St. Thomas More. We understand and recognize the difficult times in which we live, when our faith is under attack, when our right to practice our faith, our religious liberty, a right guaranteed to us by our Constitution and our laws, is also under attack. But the witness of the martyrs, the very blood of the martyrs, is a gospel that preaches to us in a very profound way. My brothers and sisters, let us have recourse to these two great saints who teach us that clergy and laity together in these difficult times must be holy, because holiness is a commandment of God, and it's the only thing that will help us to navigate these difficult times. And more than that, clergy and laity together must be profoundly courageous. Let us ask through the intercession of these two great saints that our fear of Caesar will never overcome our faith in Christ. Mm-hmm.